gosh, just tell them. Great to be here. Good to see you guys. So I'm going to talk to you a little bit about environmental regulations and really the things that we think about when we're planning the power system, when we're planning our portfolio, and how we operate, just to give you guys a flavor for that, hopefully to help the conversations that come later. And I'm also going to answer questions either now or during. I know we've got a short time, but I'm going to be here all day if you guys have specific questions. I'm going to do these things fairly high level. So when we think about it, you know, there are regulations, and the segue from the election is really a good one. There's the Clean Air Act, the Clean Water Act. You know, many of the laws that set up the regulations that we have now were passed a long time ago, passed in the 70s and some of the 80s. Certainly the Obama administration has passed on some landmark rulings, not just on the Clean Power Plan, on coal ash. Fighting a cold I had last week, so I'm still a little bit in my head. Certainly on coal ash, on clean water, and other things, but they're all based on those existing laws that were passed a long time ago. I think it's sufficient to say that it's going to be a while before we see significant legislation come out that's going to change some of these issues, but nonetheless, the legislation that we do have and been working under, and the regulations that come out of that continue to evolve as they should. So when we think about air, essentially sort of two slides to get to talking about the head. The air, water, and waste regulations, we primarily think about traditional generation when we think about these. So we think about coal plants, gas plants. Those are the typical generation sources and the pieces of our portfolio. They're impacted by these regulations. When we think about air quality, Atlanta's a great example. So, periodically you'll hear about bad ozone days, you may hear about attainment or non-attainment with the regulations. And essentially, the Clean Air Act and the Clean Water Act and others have what you might call a rinse and repeat cycle that's built into them. And so certainly as we continue to monitor, as we make improvements, as technology evolves, as we understand health effects or environmental impacts, many of the rules that we have requirements typically 5 to 8 years, when you might go back and take a look at the standards, seek to revise them, and typically the standards do indeed become more stringent for a couple of reasons. A big reason for the increased stringency, I think, is certainly around technology. So there's a technology reasonableness, practicalness to these regulations as well. What can we do? And so when we think about coal plants in particular, I mean, many of them were built in the 50s and 60s, 40s, 50s, and 60s, did not have either water discharge controls or air emission controls on those. And so as the technology has evolved and as we've understood more and more about our environmental impact, we're able to make decisions about putting controls or adding constraints to those power plants. So when we think about going from now to forward with a lot of these regulations, we think about what might the next cycle of regulations, what might the next standards, what might be the next technology requirements that we have to face. So when we think about air pollution, we typically think about NOx, nitrous oxides, ozone producing, and then SO2, sulfur dioxide. Most all the plants that you see, certainly ones are being, most all the plants are going to continue to operate, indeed have controls for those emissions. They also have controls for hazardous air pollutants, mercury and other air toxins. Those are the kinds of plants that will continue to operate. The ones that don't have those controls or have potentially controls that were built a long time ago that may not meet current standards, those are the ones that we take a hard look at in terms of are they cost effective to retrofit. If they're old plants anyway, material condition is poor, those are the kinds of plants that we would look at retiring. If the plants are in good shape and have state-of-the-art controls on them, those are the kinds of plants that we would look to continue to operate cost-effectively. We think about, I'll just mention briefly, cross-state air pollution rules. So those are the rules Georgia and many of the southeastern states have been caught up in a little bit in terms of no, and there are people here at EPA that can say It's essentially a good neighbor provision. And so, you know, a neighboring state can't emit so much of whatever the pollutant of concern is. It's going to impact the air quality, or ambient air quality, or just the, you know, what's in the air of a neighboring state. And so there are rules that EPA has set up, particularly in the eastern half of the U.S., to help us control that. And so I think, for certainly for TVA, I would say, and I assume for Southern and others, with the plant retirements that we have either in play or already done, getting ready to finish the coal plants or the transmission projects to get those plants off the grid. Not in bad shape here in the South in terms of cross-state air pollution issues. But a new rule was passed just recently that we are taking a look at. And we'll make sure that we've got the emissions and the allocations and all that to make sense. Water and waste. For both coal plants and for natural gas combined cycle, and for nuclear plants, any of these with a steam cycle, you have a hydrothermal discharge. And so they're particularly all of them here in the South, they're all cooled by water, surface water. We have a lot of water, we have that opportunity here. And so you pull in water out of the lake or out of the river, run through your cooling system like your radiator in your car, and goes back out warmer than it went in. And so many of these plants have, we take a look at it, but what is the impact of that warm water on the water quality, and really more importantly on the critters, the ecosystem that we're adding that hot water to, or warm water to. And so for those, we have cooling towers, we have limits on temperature. So those are the kinds of things that we look at. And again, those, just like the other regulations, get looked at over and over again. TVA, as many of you know, long-standing environmental sustainability and monitoring programs. So we know an awful lot about the fish and the ecosystem adjacent to our plants. And so, you know, when we think about do we have balanced populations? Do we still have indigenous populations? Do we have the right mix of populations upstream and downstream of our plants? And those are the kinds of things that will influence how much of that hydrothermal discharge and what we need to do to mitigate that hydrothermal discharge. When we think about coal plants in particular, you know, coal combustion residuals, coal ash, gypsum, the things that are produced out of the burning of coal and certainly scrubbing the emissions out of the air. We recycle a good bit of that, we being TVA in the industry. TVA is up to about 35% recycling for that those materials, typically in the construction of wallboard, concrete, cement, that kind of thing. DOTs use an awful lot of this stuff. And what's not recycled, you know, the water treatment technology of the 50s was to put it in a pond, settle out, clean enough water came out the other side of the pond. We're certainly looking at that, you know, TVA's made a commitment to go dry for ash handling in the 2009 timeframe. And we've been working toward that, and many of the other companies have been working toward dry handling and dry storage. So closing ponds, adding state-of-the-art landfills. So that work is going on as well. And so we think about certainly the coal plants that, again, will keep operating. We think about the cost and the geography of being able to close those ponds and then also build landfills to put the waste that's not recycled. Another thing that we're just starting to think, not really starting to think about, but something that we haven't wrapped our heads around yet, is thinking about the ongoing need for those materials, like so, that are used. And so that's an interesting topic that we'll continue to think about mining, those products, ash, bottom ash is kind of the granulary stuff that's used for road base, fly ash is typically used in concrete, and certainly gypsum for wallboard. So that's a source of product that the construction industry uses that we currently have enough of. But as we close coal plants, we're starting to think about how we're going to manage through that. So it's almost like the transmission system that you heard about earlier. It's a complex web that we've woven indeed. Talk about some of the other issues that we think about as well going forward. And so when we think about, you know, these are the kinds of issues that come into play when we're siting and operating, requests of siting, what we would consider, not the coal plants, they certainly are considerations when you're siting any new power plant, but certainly come into play in a bigger way, typically for renewable energy projects, solar and wind, typically have a much larger footprint than a similarly sized central station power plant. And so certainly we think about impact on land use, natural resources, wetlands, cultural resources, endangered species, all those kinds of things. So we always have consultants and experts in terms of TVA, we have our own archaeologists and endangered species biologists and such that go out and certainly we'll try to site these facilities where we can avoid or minimize the impact of these resources. And if we can't avoid or minimize, then how are we going to mitigate it? And so those are ongoing. Any new construction project, these things are certainly considered. And even more so, when we think about wind and some of the others, we think about community involvement, transparency in terms of planning, the visual impacts and those kinds of things. So it's when you think about siting or building any kind of new facility, both the permits for the facility, depending on what it's going to emit or discharge or create, and then you think about the place where it's going, what are the impacts for that place? How many places do we have where these kinds of facilities can go? And so it's a good example, the solar farm that you see up here is at the Volkswagen plant in Chattanooga. It's about 9 megawatts, it's on about 30 some acres, I think. And so that's it's a land use, underneath it all, I'm actually a forest. And so I think that it hurts me when we cut down healthy forests for a solar project, but certainly we've got plenty of places where we can put solar projects. I think the key is to make sure that we can find the right place with the right resource at the right time. And certainly that's a concern that we have any of these kinds of facilities, including the transmission lines that will connect and interconnect all of these facilities that you see up here too. So just briefly, I'll tell you a little bit about how TVA is approaching. We heard certainly here about the Clean Power Plan. TVA just brought on the first new nuclear unit in this century. Watts Bar 2 has been operating now for 20-ish days, I think it's. So we're getting very close to commercial operation. That's a huge piece. Of course, this says 17, so that Watts Bar 2 is already in there. We will be shortly. We're also building a couple of gas plants, and we've got a couple more, actually three more coal plants to final flows. But all that work is done here in the 17, 18-ish timeframe. We'll be 55% clean energy. Between our hydro, renewables, energy efficiency, and nuclear, we're looking to be more than 50%, taking more than a 50% cut on our carbon emissions, and 55% clean energy, which I think is pretty good. Are we done? No. Is there going to be more to do? Absolutely. These conversations certainly will help us inform that for sure. But that's kind of I just want to give you a flavor for some of the things we think about with both traditional central station power as well as with renewables and transmission and other kinds of things. This is how it's been played out in our most recent planning. As we do for all of these issues, we continue to rinse and repeat, look at what our impacts are, what our opportunities are, and continue to make decisions in real time. I just want to give you a flavor for some of the things we've got.